what would Newton do with an LLM? Like, what is your vision?
That's an interesting point. So what Newton would do with an LLM, if he had an LLM, which was certainly to process all previous literature. Now, to be fair, at Newton's time, somebody like Newton could read almost the entirety of any relevant literature up to his point. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking about everything from Euclid's Elements, Galileo, bits of Kepler, and he certainly wouldn't have that. Then you just go and read it, and that's fine. But now literature has grown so exponentially, there are no more Newtons, human Newtons, that could possibly read the entire literature of a field. And that's where LLMs could come in to help. So this is in the LLM space of discovery. You can summarize literature, and you can try to create new possible links between literature. And this is happening now, I think. I think LLAMA, LLAMA, which is LLM for math, like LLAMA, double L, LLAMA. LLAMA is something, it's an AI tool that's beginning to digest the archive, for example. And on the other hand, that's the LLM side of the story. And now what about the other half is, how could Newton, based on mathematical patterns, and he did have a lot of patterns, it would be things like, this would be mathematical data. So certainly that he had data in terms of theoretical and experimental physics, where you know you could measure the rolling of the kind of stuff that Galileo did, the rolling of balls along inclined planes, that kind of data. Or he had the astronomical data of Kepler, but he also would have had mathematical data or Platonic data. I like this word Platonic data because it's pure. The kind of data that would be like sets of polynomial equations in two variables, which he actually tried to classify himself. How many cubics, because he knew about the conic classification problem. And he would look at these things, and then he would spot patterns. And this kind of stuff also gave rise, I would imagine, I can't imagine, you know, the mind of Newton, but I would imagine he would look at vast amounts of such data, and then try to formulate a theory out of it.
Ah, okay.
And that's kind of really nice. So that's an LLM independent thing. This is just pattern spotting. So like Newton, there are these things called Newton polynomials, which expresses, it's a technical thing, which would be Newton, a certain symmetric polynomials in multivariables being expressible in some basis. I would imagine Newton would have written pages and pages of this stuff and spotted a pattern and then tried to prove a general theorem, which is now the theory of Newton polynomials.
I thought where you were going was this amorphous ideation with an LLM. So for instance, Newton would say, okay, I have balls coming down an incline. I don't have a precise formula for velocity. I don't even know if velocity is a great concept, but I noticed that it moves faster, but it can also, so that may be associated with something I would call acceleration, but then there's something else like an impact, which I may call force. Can you help me with this? Is there a way to make this concrete, like to take something that's ill-defined and make it well-defined? I thought that's where you're going. Do you think LLMs help with that, or is that not what you're thinking about?
No. I think that definitely helps a bit. We're not quite there yet, I think, where we could just start asking LLMs and say, here's the literature, digest it all, and give me new possible links. But we are actually not insanely far away from that goal now, because the LLMs are getting so good at doing this sort of thing. So it's actually not impossible. In some sense, Newton would, the mind of Newton is something like that. I guess, let me see my next slide. I think I do mention, that the another mind as great as Newton and Gauss, and I will give that example in a minute as well.
All right, let's get back to the presentation.
Oh, so I think, I can't remember whether, speaking of Newton, I can't remember whether I talked about this last time. If not, this is a joke worth repeating again, which is, what is the best neural network of the 18th century? You could argue the 17th century was Newton, and the best neural network of the 18th to 19th century is clearly the brain of Gauss.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another, here's a very, very good example as well of just top-down intuition-guided mathematics. And I might have mentioned this last time, but it's worth repeating. So what is the thought process of this great discovery here? So everybody knew about the primes. You know, Euclid already proved that there's an infinite number of primes. And the proof is very, very beautiful, and it's kind of intricate. It's the first thing you would teach in a number theory course. It's not obvious at all there's an infinite number of number of primes, but Euclid had this proof by contradiction argument why there should be an infinite number of them. So Gauss certainly would have known that proof. But Gauss wanted to know more, and it's been 2,000 years since Euclid. Gauss wanted to know about more details about the distribution of primes. We know the primes get rarer and rarer, even though there's an infinite number of them. They do get rarer and rarer. How rarer do they get? And he just devised this function, which we now call the prime counting function, P of X. It's a terrible name because P is pi, but it got stuck in the literature. And P of X is just simply the number of prime numbers less than a given positive real number X. So that was one of his insights, was to devise this function, which is now continuous, because primes are inherently discrete. And this is very interesting. He plotted this, and he looked at this curve. Invented regression, apparently, in order to do a curve fitting, because he needed, this is all done at the age of 16. He invented regression to see, well, what is the best shape that fits this? And all of this done by hand. And he even had to compute the primes into the hundreds of thousands because the tables stopped there. And he even got some of them wrong because it's a very boring and tedious computation. Imagine what Gauss could have done. One, if he had Math Sage or Mathematica, he could have, how much more conjectures would have raised, right?
Well, the problem with that is that if he has access to the modern tools, he also has access to TikTok, and it's not clear if Gauss would be born.
Yeah, well, let's hope that because Gauss is Gauss, he wouldn't waste his time doing like watching YouTube videos. But and watch more meaning, maybe he would, maybe he'll watch meaningful YouTube videos, like other conversations, like the kind of conversation you put on Theories of Everything.
Okay, great.
But anyway, but he would do this thing. And he looked at this P of X, and he says, it's clearly X over natural log of X. You won't be able to see this just by looking. So he really actually had to invent regression to do this. And so statistics was a side product of this problem. As far as I know, I could, but this needs to be checked with real historians of science. But at least that's the story here. And this is just crazy. Like, what do you even do? And the proof of this fact was given 50 years later by Adamard and de la Vallée-Poussin, because you had to wait for Cauchy and Riemann to invent complex analysis in order to give a tool to prove this fact. So how did Gauss know this? Based on just, at the time, would surely be called large data, right? He really went into the tens and hundred thousand range,
uh-huh,
in order to spot this kind of patterns. And it's just amazing. And I can plot this because if you just plot the first 100 or so, it looks kind of like a log or kind of like a line or something. But you really need to go into the thousands or tens of thousands range in order to do something like this. So amazing. That's exactly the kind of top-down guiding intuition. There was not even the foundation to prove something like this until years later. Riemann as well, I mean, a great example. Riemann hypothesis, which is arguably the most famous open problem in all of human intellect, and is certainly the one that we all bow down and worship. It's about, so the Riemann hypothesis has so many implications in mathematics. It's one of the Millennium Prize problems. And the Riemann hypothesis, it's so important precisely because there are now probably tens of thousands of mathematics papers whose first opening line is, let us assume that the Riemann hypothesis is correct, and the rest of the paper. So it has so many implications. So that's the kind of conjectures that are great, that it has implications to so many other possible results. The interesting about the Riemann hypothesis is that it appeared as a footnote in Riemann's paper. Riemann was just doing the Riemann zeta function precisely to address a similar problem to this, to the precise distribution of primes, and he wrote in a footnote that I checked the first couple of zeros, and they all have real part a half. I believe that this is true, but I don't really need this result right now. It really, you can see that amazing footnote, and then that we just said, I can't think about this right now, but I think this is kind of interesting. And then that was the beginning, the birth of that. Now, how did Riemann intuit something like this?
Well, these number theorists and their margins.
Exactly. Number theorists love margins. Exactly. Now, yeah, I never thought of it. That's a good point. But that's actually extremely good point you mentioned. They're written into margins because they haven't been formally proved. If it's structured, it would be bottom-up mathematics and it would be in the main text. And often these marginalia are just afterthoughts or just sparks of genius of these people who would just relegate this thing to a side comment. And that kind of intuition leads to centuries of research. So that's a very good point you raise about how the difference between margins and formal text, because papers are written, whether it's pure mathematics or theoretical physics, papers are written in a very structured backwards kind of way, from quite different from the way they're reached in this intuitive kind of way. Yeah, so that's a good point. Yeah. And then this doesn't stop, and this is something that the memoration stuff will get more into, which is this BST conjecture, which is another Millennium Prize problem. This is another one that carries a $1 million tag. And how did this come about? And I will talk more about what the BST conjecture is. This is Brian Birch, who is still alive. He's, I think, 90-something. You know, mathematicians are very long-lived because they're happy. And the Birches went and died in the 60s. They're in the basement in Cambridge. And they just plotted loads and loads of data for ranks of and conductors of elliptic curve. Now, lots by 1960 standards would be in the order of hundreds to thousands. The LMFDB, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, is a database of 3.6 million curves. So we've progressed quite a bit. 3.6 million is a kind of data scale where you could really train things on. And that's where I could really come in. And this just in the stop. They plotted this and they raised this conjecture. They noticed a certain pattern between R and ranks, these technical terms, which I'm going to define in a minute. And that was the birth of yet another great and foundational problem. And this is regarded as a central piece of mathematics as well.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.